The county proposes to adopt a real property tax rate of 1.018 per $100 of assessment. This tax rate is 1.8% higher than the constant yield tax rate and will generate $3,536,861 in additional property tax revenues. Now, to briefly summarize the budgets that have been proposed, the general fund, or what's often called the operating budget, $417,501,830. The capital fund, $65,432,709. The solid waste enterprise fund, $8,224,770. The septage enterprise fund, $1,073,750. The water and sewer enterprise fund, $15,077,020. The airport enterprise fund, $1,030,990. Firearms facility enterprise fund, $159,200. Fiber network enterprise fund, $445,000. Pension trust fund, $4,487,350. Special revenue fund, $2,911,960. Grants fund, $16,405,796. OPEB fund, $13,093,310. LOSAP fund, $398,000. The commissioners have proposed water and sewer rates for the next three budget years. So this is a lot of numbers coming. The usage rates are billed per 1,000 gallons per quarter. For fiscal year 20, the base charge per quarter for water, $9.93. For sewer, $13.92. Usage rate for 10,000 gallons or less, $7.34 water, $8.98 sewer. 10,001 to 30,000 gallons, $7.50 water, $9.51 sewer. Over 30,000 gallons, $7.68 water, $10.08 sewer. For fiscal year 21, base charge per quarter, $10.73 water, $15.08 sewer. Less than 10,000 gallons, $7.94 water, $9.30 sewer. 10,001 to 30,000 gallons, $8.12 water, $9.88 sewer. Over 30,000 gallons, $8.35 water, $10.53 sewer. And for fiscal year 21, base charge, $11.52 water, $16.25 sewer. Less than 10,000 gallons, $8.54 water, $9.63 sewer. 10,001 to 30,000 gallons, $8.75 water, $10.25 sewer. And more than 30,000 gallons, $9.01 water, $10.99 sewer. Okay, I'll call out the first five names. Please come up front to one of the microphones. And remember, keep an eye on the screen to watch your available time. Donna Savigny, Stephen Lockard, Teresa McCullough, Mira Foote, and Gary Foote.
Good evening, Commissioners. I am Donna Savigny, President of the Board of Education, and I am here this evening to advocate for education and educators in Carroll County. The Board of Ed would like to thank you for the funding increase of $3.9 million for FY20, but we would also like to reiterate what we said at our joint meeting less than 2 weeks ago. We need an additional $1 million in order to fund our anticipated salary negotiations and access the $2.3 million Kirwan State grant money for teachers. At the joint meeting, you asked what additional cuts need to be made if you do not give us the $1 million of funds. I'm not going to stand here and trot out the old politically charged remarks like, we will cut outdoor school, or athletics, or the fine arts, because in all honesty, we have no intention of doing those things. We are also not going to cut any more teachers or staff. which would have a negative impact on student services and achievement. Therefore, it can only come from salaries and going back to the negotiating table. We have already reduced our local request by the full amount of additional Thornton money from the state. We have also completely removed all requests for strategic plan initiatives to help teachers in the classroom. We have developing problems that we have identified as part of our strategic plan, but we will not be able to address any of these problems with the current funding allocation. You also appear to have written down an additional $1.7 million of funds in FY20 and several hundred thousand in FY21. Are these funds still available? I would request that the commissioners look hard at this money and note that the $1 million of funds we are requesting only represents 0.2% of your overall budget. We are a fiscally responsible board that watches and questions every penny. We represent a much lower percentage of the overall county budget than other Maryland counties. We have cut all discretionary spending. We are simply asking for inflationary and anticipated negotiated. We have proven when you invest in us, you get great results. The additional $1 million we are requesting would allow us to access the Kerwin Teacher Salary Grant of $2.3 million, provide an immediate 230% ROI to the county, appropriately pay our educators, and continue to provide an outstanding school system to our county residents. Gentlemen, that's just good business. This is not a case of us versus them. It is not about winning or losing a negotiation. We are not competing against each other. It is about collaboration and working together to do the right thing. Therefore, I am humbly and respectfully requesting that you reallocate just $1 million of additional funds to CCPS for FY20. Thank you.
Good evening, and thanks for the opportunity to speak. I'm Steve Lockard, Superintendent of Carroll County Public Schools. As the county's largest employer, CCPS is a great school system with talented, dedicated employees that work tirelessly on behalf of students. We believe we add tremendous value to Carroll County. This year, the board concluded a process to develop a new strategic plan for our school system. The process started more than 18 months ago and included a review of key data and feedback from a wide array of community stakeholders. The finalized plan outlines our objectives and priorities for the next several years. As I examined system resources and developed a recommended budget to the board, I tried to find a balanced approach that included competitive pay for employees and priority improvements based on the data and feedback behind the strategic plan. I also recognized that our budget request needed to be reasonable. To that end, I carefully considered what we've asked for in the past and what the county has funded. The request submitted was for 4.6% or $8.9 million in increase in local funding, which was the lowest request in the past 5 years. We believe this to be necessary to negotiate a competitive increase for employees and consider key positions that represented the highest priorities for student needs outlined in the strategic plan. For the first time since fiscal year 9, our budget proposes no additional position reductions. From fiscal years 9 through 19, we cut over $35 million in expenditures, including 375 positions. Although enrollment did decline, the needs of our students and the severity of student challenges have not decreased, and I would argue have become more complex and significant. I have heard loud and clear from teachers, staff, and community that we cannot continue to reduce existing positions. For the first time in many years, we will receive an increase from the state foundational funding of $2.7 million. This is very helpful to us. The General Assembly also produced a 2-year funding bill for the Kerwin Commission recommendations. However, that funding is restricted, except for a small portion for existing full-day pre-K students. In light of your preliminary budget release, combined with the state foundation funding, but considering the restricted nature of the Kerwin funds, we are still approximately $1 million short of being able to fund our operations and meet our anticipated negotiated agreements with all 5 of our bargaining units. None of the recommended school-based positions in support of the strategic plan are being considered. For some perspective, last year, we appreciated the 2.96% or $5.5 million increase from the county. However, even with that, we had to cut approximately $5.8 million in positions and other expenditures just to meet our negotiated agreements and inflation and balance our budget. I thank you for the $3.9 million increase that was already in your FY20 plan and respectfully request an additional $1 million of ongoing revenue. This would raise county funding from 3.9 to 4.9 million. Thank you for your consideration and for the opportunity to address you this evening.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm Teresa Basler McCullough, president of the Carroll County Education Association, proudly representing the sea of red behind me this evening and who have been coming out in droves in other public meetings. Same scenario, different year. The Board of Education has made their request to the Board of County Commissioners, and here we are asking for the education budget to be fully funded. However, there is a slight twist this year, being that the original request and the additional ask may have not been the ideal approach. However, the financial need still remains. In addition, and thankfully, the Kerwin Commission has affected the budget. $2 million cannot be left at the table, and June 30th is fast approaching. What this means to the community is, during the General Assembly, a bill was passed called the Blueprint for Education Bill, which includes a grant for teacher salaries. The caveat to that grant is a school district and the teacher bargaining unit need to bargain for at least a 3% salary hike. When this happens, there is a 1.5% state match, which for Carroll County is $2,285,287. Despite the message that was put forth at the Joint Board of Education, Board of Commissioners meeting, negotiations are not over. Again, I repeat, negotiations are not over. Unfortunately, there is another similarity as in years past. While deliberations over the budget are at hand, that dreadful tug of war takes place, putting educators and students smack dab in the middle of the rope. Let the game end. Raising educator salaries and maintaining quality education was part of each of your campaigns. Be an integral part of this being the year of the educator. Working conditions are learning conditions. Our educators deserve to be valued, respected, appreciated, and have earned a salary increase. Our students deserve the finest, and we know the way to keep Carroll County's best is by fully funding the budget request. Thank you for your time.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Mira. My name is Mira Foote, and I'm an assistant professor here at the Community College. In an April 25th article in the New York Times, Richard Kahlenberg, an expert on education, writes about school funding and how that funding impacts students. Because of federal funding, four-year schools are able to spend $72,000 per full-time student per year. Kahlenberg reports that private research universities spend triple what community colleges do, and that public research universities spend 60% more. More importantly, he shares, careful research has found significant causal impacts of spending on degree completion. Scholars looking at community colleges between 1990 and 2013 found that a 10% spending increase raised the number of awards of certificates and degrees bestowed by 15%. When students complete an associate degree, they see their lifetime earnings increase on average by more than $300,000. Community colleges depend upon state and local government money from you gentlemen, and I ask you tonight that you do more to offer us more options and support for our students. Our students need this support more than students at four-year schools. In Kallenberg's words, my students are, quote, striving low-income working class and minority students, end quote. My students work between 20 and 50 hours a week while taking between 6 and 18 credits a semester, depending on how many credits they could afford at any time. My students have many more cares than the average four-year college student. Many of them care for elderly relatives and young siblings at home. Many are war veterans dealing with the emotional and physical fallout from serving this great country. We offer here at Carroll a growing variety of innovative scholarships and a variety of other incentives and support systems to help them fund and then follow through with their educational commitments. However, with more funding, we could do more. At Carroll Community College, we use our funding to institute the most inspiring and exciting educational innovations such as ALP, the Accelerated Learning Program, which helps transitional study students move forward into credit programming with more success. We offer students theater and performing arts and fine arts programs that are second to none. Our STEM programming offers sweeping opportunities that galvanize student interest and garner impressive successes. Moreover, we use our funding to incorporate the benefits of high-tech advising and retention tool to support our students. However, we struggle to find the money to offer all the classes we want to offer. We struggle to replace aging technology equipment. In short, we're doing beautiful work using the funding you offer in an efficient and creative way, but we need more funding, please. Commissioners, we need you to commit more funding to us because in Kallenberg's words, the success or failure of the 9 million students who attend America's Community College has a lot of influence on whether America's promise of social mobility will be kept. What is truly at stake here is the question of whether this country can meaningfully be considered a meritocracy. To a significant degree, this crucial aspect of the American dream is in your hands, gentlemen. If we want our Carroll Community College students to be able to become self-supporting middle-class American citizens, we need to make a commitment to fund their educational efforts more generously. Thank you, sirs, for all that you do, but please do more. Thank you.
Good evening. Today, this week, marks the 65th anniversary of the Brown versus Board of Education decision, and sadly, I will be making many of the same comments today that were probably made in 1954. Segregation is still a violation of the 14th Amendment's Equal Protection Clause, and too many of our students still lack access to opportunity. Much has been said, and even more has been written, about the recent cheating scandal involving America's elite private schools. But I am here today to advocate for public education, which works not for the 1%, but for the 100%. We work with the students who have to miss class because they are caring for an ailing parent, or they must care for a younger sibling, or they can't focus because they haven't really eaten well for days, or they don't know where they'll be sleeping next week. The wealthiest private schools get funding to the tune of $72,000 per student. Public education, including our community college, gets barely a fifth of that. I am here tonight to challenge you to figure out what spending would be required to ensure that all Carroll students could enter the middle class by the 10th year after graduation. Here we are in the second decade of this 21st century, and we don't really even know what that amount would be. Let's figure it out. We know that a two-year associate's degree from our local community college means $300,000 extra of earnings over a lifetime. And some certifications take even less time and are even more lucrative. Right now, 85% of our community college students say they will transfer to a four-year top school after they finish at Carroll. Only 14% actually make it. 62% of community college students never finish a degree or obtain a certificate of any kind, even after 6 years. What would our community be like if we fixed that? This fix will require better K-12 education too, and let's be clear. A state-of-the-art community college does no good if there aren't students in the county who can take advantage of the facility. And a world-class K-12 system doesn't do much good if the opportunities are limited after high school. Let's not wait another 62 5 years to tap into the vast pool of talent so many of our students would bring to our community if we only gave them a chance.
Okay, our next five speakers, David Fell, Andrea Burstler, Melvin Bale Jr., Linda Glabick, Beth Gray.
All right. Good evening. My name is David Fell, and I'm a professor here at Carroll Community College. Welcome to the college. I'm here tonight to advocate for our funding request for a 3% salary increase for our employees. And that request is particularly important this year and over the next couple because our college is going to be going through its reaccreditation process culminating in the year 2021. And to prepare for that, the students and faculty and staff at the college will be working hard. We'll be doing a self-report over the next couple years, a lot of committee work. So we'll be calling upon people to work extra hard for this very important process. We also want to have good morale among our employees and staff at that time. We want to have a good story and a positive image to show when the accreditors come. So for those reasons, I just want you to keep that, all of that in mind over the next couple years when we ask for a funding increase and especially for salaries. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Linda Glabick. I work at Century High School. I have been at Century High School. I've been in Carroll County for 15 years. I came here from Buffalo, New York. I have to tell you that when I got here, I was shocked because the salary that I was offered was $25,000 less than I was making in Buffalo, New York. That's a big city, in case you don't know where it is. So I have been 35 years in education. This is actually my last. I have 26 days left. I have loved Carroll County. I was offered a job in Montgomery County where I live when I first came here and I said, no, I preferred the job at North Carroll High School and then I moved to Century High School here and I've never thought about working in Montgomery County even though that's where my son went to school. This is a great county. But you are not paying your staff to stay here. So I can't even count on all my fingers and all my toes, all the people that have left Century High School to go to Howard County, Baltimore County, Montgomery County, Frederick County, et cetera. In addition to that, so I work in as an ETM rep, which is equity education. There are five minority people in our school. Only one is a teacher, actually two. One is a JROTC staff member. And that's a lot that I can understand from some of the other schools. So I saw the equity education, the thing that went through the board the other night talking about equity education, et cetera. But how are we attracting these people to come here? They're not getting the salaries, they're not getting the pay, and they're not getting the support to come here. So basically, I work every day from 7 to 5 at school, and then I go home and I grade papers for a couple more hours and get ready for school the next day. So it's constant. If you haven't been in the classroom, and I know some of you have, but if you haven't been, I suggest that you go and just work one day in a classroom. Let the teacher sit in the back of the room and you do it. See how much it opened your eyes to what actually happens. I would invite you to my classroom. Please do so. I have offered to pay people my day salary to come and work in my classroom, people who complain about what teachers make and summers off and all these things. I go to classes every summer and learn how to teach what I'm teaching. So please think very, very long and hard about all of this funding, all these funding issues, and what's happening and why these people are leaving and constantly looking to other districts to go elsewhere. Because this is a great county, but you gotta ante up and pay your teachers and your staff members. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Andrea Burstler. I am the Executive Director for Carroll County Public Library. I'm very proud to be so. I want to thank the commissioners for their continued support of our library system. The support that you provide and the continued level of support that you provide has allowed us to have a top-performing library system in the state. We are second highest in circulations per capita in the state. We have over 150 teams in our last battle of the books that involved over 1,000 students from the Carroll County Public School System, private schools, parochial schools, and homeschoolers. There was a record 9 battles this year. And this is an amazing, I know you were, the commissioners were all at different events, and we saw a lot of children who were excited about reading and excited about literacy. And we are planning for this year's Summer Discovery, our summer reading program that involves students and adults across the county. And again, people get excited about literacy and reading and education. Your support has allowed our staff to continue to serve on boards and leadership positions throughout the state and has made Carroll County Public Library a leader across Maryland. Your support has also allowed us to continue to work on Exploration Commons, our brand new project in the Westminster Library that will be a state-of-the-art high-tech maker space, a commercial teaching kitchen, and a community meeting space. This will provide for innovation, collaboration, digital fabrication. It will support education and economic development and prepare our citizens for a life in a high-tech economy. I just want to say thank you for your support. It means that we have a high-quality library service available for every citizen of Carroll County. Thank you.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm Melvin Bale, Jr., and I want to make sure that you understand I'm not here as a Board of Zoning Appeals member, but I'm here to talk about ag land preservation. The funds have been cut the last 2 years and been put in other programs. And one of the things that I think you need to realize is the ag preservation program is a long-term program. It's not a short-term program. The program started in 1978. We're at almost 75,000 acres. The stated goal in the master plan is 100,000 acres. Now, to put that into perspective, we've got about 289,000 total acres in Carroll County. Today, there's somewhere between 160 and 165,000 acres that are devoted to agriculture. Of that, we have a conservation zone, and we also have remainders. So I would really encourage you to get a group together before next year's budget and see at what point we will not be able to reach our 100,000 acre goal, because the available land mass that we have is in conservation zoning and it's also in agricultural remainders. They're not counted towards that 100,000 acre goal. The master plan states that the preferred use of land and the preferred use of land in Carroll County is ag. And all that we're looking at, the goal that was stated in the past master plans is 1/3 of the land mass. That's all we're asking for. So the one good thing about for ag land preservation here in Carroll County this year is that we have a governor that didn't raid the state funds. And you did fund enough money so that you can get the matching for every dollar you put into the state program. They match it very well. It's more than $1, $2 to $3. So I just want you to look at this as a long range plan. It's a stated goal in our master plan. And because it's a stated goal in the master plan, there should be a financial responsibility that goes with that. Thank you very much.
Calls for a comprehensive traffic study for the Freedom area. Last week, I attended one of Mr. Gillespie's budget presentations and learned that $30,000 has been stripped from the 2020 budget for such studies. Additionally, I learned that $75,000 to $80,000 does remain available for such studies, but that is for the entire county. Freedom has been at times the golden goose, the cash cow, with much revenue raised on the backs of the homeowners in the area. But as an unincorporated area, yet also the designated growth area, we have not had many of the financial resources required to do what is needed. These past 4 years, we have said, and we are still saying, we must have the resources allotted so that growth initiated in the Freedom Plan is in keeping with wise, safe planning. As you recall, some of our main concerns have been growth without careful management of needed infrastructure, of slow-moving traffic, hazardous intersections such as Johnville and 32 and Johnsville and 26, as well as many other hazardous roads and near-failing intersections throughout the Freedom area. Please be true to the commitments you have inherited. Please be sure that money is allowed for this most necessary of road studies. Do not neglect the citizens of Freedom. And while we fully recognize the many difficult choices before you in this year's very trying financial times, we, the FDCA, ask you to consider putting the $30,000 back in good faith for this much needed comprehensive traffic study. Please remember, this is now one of your priorities too. Thank you for your time and your consideration of our request.
Next speakers, Robert Herbstomer, Mary Kowalski, Tom Scanlon, Tina Hahn, and Jennifer Weitzel.
Good evening. I'm Bob Herbstomer, a resident of Finksburg and a teacher for 43 years. Well, here we are once again, educators coming before you asking to fully fund the needs of the school system. It seems like this is one of the few things that have not changed over my 43 years in education. Year after year, educators are forced to come before you to ask to fully fund the Board of Education's request. I was under the impression that this year it was going to be different, that the Board of Commissioners and the Board of Education were going to work collaboratively to come up with a funding plan for our schools. Unfortunately, here we are once again, this year with a $1 million gap between what the Board of Education needs and what the Board of Commissioners will provide. What happened? It saddens me to think that my future grandchildren will not have the same excellent educational experience in Carroll County schools that my children did. After years of cutting budgets to the bone and having taken a toll on our schools, in many cases, staff is stretched to the limit. Many of our talented teachers have left Carroll County for neighboring counties. Even with the best efforts of our Human Resources Department, minority staffing is nowhere near reaches the percentages of minority students in our system. We cannot hire enough speech therapists, so the county has to settle for using non-county employees brought in from a private agency. Something has to change if you want to continue and enjoy the benefits of a first-class public school system. I'm asking you to look to the future and fully fund the needs of Carroll County Public Schools. Thank you.
Trying to find that. Good evening, commissioners. My name is Mary Kowalski. I live in the Westminster area, and I grew up in Carroll County, and it's very disturbing for me to see what's happening in this budget. As we all know, property taxes are going up. Now that you've released your proposed budget, we can see why taxes are going up. Several red flags have caught my attention. The first is the proposal to spend $300,000 for a new position, a new paid county fire chief and assistant. Come on, gentlemen. You, our county commissioners, have said you would like to transition away from our volunteer-based fire departments to a, quote, fully funded, end quote, system. This is unacceptable power grab. And this is financially irresponsible. You know, look, we've already been told that mandatory preschool is looming, quote, looming. This is not the time for a power grab by our county commissioners of our volunteer fire departments. You know, this reminds me of the power grab, attempted power grab by the county commissioners a few years back when they tried to replace our citizen-elected sheriff with a politically appointed chief of police. Because that's what this would be, a politically appointed fire chief, county-wide fire chief, politically appointed. Our delegation to Annapolis stepped in and made sure that the commissioner's proposal for an appointed chief of police would have to go to a ballot referendum. Well, that was the end of that. The county commissioners immediately backed off. They knew the citizens were against it, just like they know the citizens are against this. If they knew about it, where's the public outreach? Where's the public outreach? So we need to ask our delegation to require this dramatic change in the structure of our fire department system to be put on a ballot referendum. Listen, we have great, highly trained volunteer fire departments, supported financially by community events like carnivals, bingos, and the like. In addition, our community fire departments already receive a large amount of funding from the county. Also, excuse me, but the president of the Board of Commissioners just recently stated that there's no problem, quote, no problem with getting volunteers in Carroll County. So if it ain't broke, commissioners, let's not try to fix it, please. Another red flag in the budget is, of course, the airport runway to nowhere. This was a privately owned airport for decades, and it should be put back in private hands. Instead, you want to buy a whopping 185 acres and make the airport almost twice as big? Dislocating families and small businesses. This is reckless to enlarge the airport right next to the biggest city in Westminster. And just recently, you voted for a $12 million bond debt without even holding a public hearing. So stop the runway to nowhere. Irresponsible decisions are wasting our tax dollars. Thank you.
You are traveling through another dimension, a dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind, a journey into a wondrous land of imagination, the land where school systems are adequately funded. Next stop, the education zone. You know, 3 years ago, I stood at this microphone and said that I understood the constraints you face and the balancing act you have to perform to balance the county budget. 3 years ago, I suggested that fully funding the school system should be your starting point when creating a budget. And 3 years ago, and many others, advocated that increasing county revenue was necessary to fund the county budget. So what exactly has changed in those years? A couple of new faces on the stage, and beyond that, not much. So yeah, this feels a lot like the Twilight Zone. So CCPS has whittled down its budget request to bare bones once again. The morale of educators is about as low as I've seen it in my 31 years in the county because of tight budgets. These budget hearings never really change, so it's time to change the paradigm. The good people of this community expect quality services. This costs money. Carroll County Public Schools is the best in the state. Hands down. So you can thank us by making sure the school system has the funds it needs to continue its legacy. So gentlemen, submitted for your approval. Show us that public schools are valued by fully funding our budget. Support our work by going beyond what the superintendent has requested. Keep CCPS at the top. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Tina Hahn, and I'm a lab tech over at college right here, Carroll Community College. And I just want to support what the professors were saying to continue funding our college. That's how I got my start in life, was a community college. It was basically my ticket out of the trailer park. And I went on, got a four-year degree. Now I'm Very happy to support the STEM programs here at Carroll Community College as a lab tech. So I'm just hoping that if you can find it in your hearts to give us the 3-year raise this year, that would be most awesome. Thank you so much for your support.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm here to ask your board to find a way to fully fund the CCPS budget request, which includes the $1 million reallocation, as I do not wish to see our school system have to make any more cuts at this time. I don't think the system could afford it, as I truly believe additional cuts would weaken CCPS, thereby weakening our schools, communities, and county as a whole. As a frequent volunteer at my children's schools and also a part-time substitute teacher, it's clear to me that we do not have all these extra bells and whistles within our school system. But we do a lot with what we have, but our people are spread thin. I was actually a public school teacher in Howard County before my children were born 12 years ago, and I can tell you a lot has changed since then. I would argue that it's more challenging now than ever than before to teach, and I would be willing to bet that most of our veteran teachers would agree emphatically with this. I think we could all agree that our general student population becomes more challenging each year moving forward. We have more and more kids that have been victims of some sort of trauma and or addiction. We have more students dealing with depression, anxiety, other emotional issues, and we know behavioral issues are on the rise, especially at the elementary school level. This year, teachers have even created calming corners within their classrooms as one example of a way to help mitigate some of these disruptions. We know our special education population is growing more each year, and the system is currently running on a deficit in that category, having to creatively find the additional dollars to plug the gaps there each year. Couple all of this with the reality that the expectations of our student outcomes have not changed, only increased. Teachers and support staff constantly have to find ways to keep students actively engaged and achieving at a high level. Teachers and other staff members are wearing more hats than ever before. So, with all of this in mind, I feel strongly that CCPS staff job descriptions across the board have been expanded as a natural response to the increase in student needs. Our system is one of the best in the state, I'd say the best in the state, and we need to continue to retain and attract solid educators and personnel while remaining competitive with surrounding school districts. For these reasons, the amount set aside for negotiated agreements must not be reduced. The proposed CCPS budget is austere. The fact that the board took all 29 positions off of the table is a clear demonstration of how much they need the $1 million. You don't know me, but I'm a fiscal conservative. I'm fully aware of the difficult position that you're all in, and that all agencies have made cuts and found efficiencies to work within a tight budget. But CCPS cannot go farther at this time, in my opinion, without cracking the foundation, so to speak. The question was posed from Commissioner Rothstein at the last joint meeting. What would happen if you don't get the $1 million that you're asking for? I would imagine it may involve cuts in positions, less dollars for negotiations, or program cuts such as outdoor school. But please know that as a parent, I strongly oppose any and all of these cuts at this time. I actually remain hopeful that we can start improving the system moving forward, adding additional people, resources, or programs that address the surmounting issues as identified by the strategic plan before it negatively affects our student outcomes. Please reallocate the additional $1 million to our school system. I thank you very much for your time and your dedication to our county. Thank you.
Is there anybody who would like to speak who has not turned in a card? Okay, our last two speakers then, John Corona and Karen Leatherwood.
Good evening, gentlemen. You propose spending between $4.7 and $5 million per year on AgPres, and 61% of our farms operate at a loss. I'd like you to rethink the AgPres program and do it smarter. I'd like you to support farmers whose primary occupation is agriculture and who are committed to the success of the sector. The objective should not be to preserve our heritage. The objective should be to support farmers who intend to earn a living to engage in sustainable agriculture that's profitable and that will attract youth into the profession. I'm disappointed with the discussions on the benefits for CCSO sworn officers. That was a priority of the 60th board. It was also stated to be a priority of yours. For some reason, the legwork that needed to be done to support constructive deliberations didn't happen. I don't think the outcome in the proposed budget reflects the county's values, and I think you need to dedicate more time and thought to that issue. With regard to public education, I think you need to play a greater role. To be certain, you'll always be interested in the funding it needs to happen, but I think you need to play a larger part in raising expectations about what the school system should be doing and what our students can achieve. I think there are a lot of positive things occurring in the education reform efforts that you can support. I know accountability is important to you. I know that teacher compensation is important to you. I would like to see an emphasis on education reforms that may or may not involve fiscal support, greater school autonomy, employment diversity, but overall, raising expectations of what the school system can do. Your general budgeting philosophy is that the budget and five-year plan should reflect your expectations and your intentions. Any departure from that general philosophy should be rare, and it should be justified to the public. I am concerned that there is no program or project in place regarding new school construction or modernization. So right now, the public is left concluding that there is no project contemplated. Again, I can encourage you to deliberate more about that and make sure that your discussions and your budget and plan reflect your true intentions. I am dissatisfied with the revenue write-down that occurred at the 11th hour. If taxpayers are expected to contribute revenues to the county, they expect them to be used for worthy public projects or set aside in a transparent manner. That decision was not transparent, and it should be reversed. Finally, I don't think you dedicated enough time to your unfunded retirement plan obligations and liabilities. I think you should discuss those and make sure that you're on track and on trajectory to an acceptable funding level. I think that's important, and somehow it was not covered. Finally, I thank you for the complete transparency of your budgeting process. That is a fantastic asset of the county. Thank you.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm Karen Leatherwood, and I live in the Freedom area. And I just wasn't going to speak this evening, but I just wanted to take the opportunity to thank you all for the yeoman's work that you've done. As has been the case for a number of years now, you have very limited resources, and you have many, many, many worthy causes coming and asking you for consideration and for additional funding. And I know that you've heard some compelling requests this evening, and now you have a week and a half to go back and sharpen the pencil, and I just want to thank you. I'm standing here not representing anyone this evening, but I'd like to imagine that I'm representing the folks that were too busy at a baseball game or making dinner for their family or something, who are overall very satisfied with the direction that this county's headed and very appreciative of your service. Thank you.
Okay, commissioners, that's all of our speakers.
All right, on behalf of my colleagues, we would, as always, like to thank all of those that have been engaged in this process, whether it be from the beginning or to this point. We will now have a couple work sessions that we have scheduled.